76, acute abdominal pain, raised lactate, tachycardia, gut ischemia, gut obstruction, that kind of a clinical. Over to you.
Okay. Just going to make my way to the top of the abdomen. I'm presented with axial slices of the CT abdomen in the portal venous phase. I'm just going to scroll through, see if anything catches my eye. Okay, so I can see that in the lower abdomen pelvis, there are numerous loops of small bowel which do not show any mural enhancement. There's perienteric free fluid and fat stranding. With the history of raised lactate, this is suggestive of ischemia. I'm just going to trace the rest of the bowel, starting from the rectum.
Right. So what do you think has happened? Your finding is spot on.
Yeah. So essentially, there are loops of dilated small bowel which show air fluid levels in the lower abdomen pelvis. I can't appreciate any enhancement of these the walls. And there's perienteric fluid and inflammatory changes suggesting ischemia. In my routine practice, I would follow all of the bowel initially to see the extent of involvement. Then I would look at the vessels that the mesenteric vessels to see to find a cause, whether there's a thrombus in the SMV. SMV is patent. I'm just going to assess the arterial system, celiac trunk. I can appreciate SMA, this normal opacification. So I can't find any thrombus in the proximal mesenteric vessels. However, my findings are in keeping with small bowel ischemia. I would, in my routine practice, look at the rest of the solid abdominal organs.
What is the cause of this ischemia? You did well where you have ruled out, you know, other causes, arterial, things like that. What is the cause then? What is happening?
Okay. Just going to have to look at it in a bit more detail now. Okay, could I have a look at the coronal, please? Coronal images, please. I have a feeling that these...
Leave the mouse, please. Here you are.
So I have a feeling that some of these kind of these bound loops have the C-shaped loop appearance. So I'm just...
Which shape appearance?
Like a C-shaped appearance.
What does that mean?
Concerned about the closed loop obstruction, possibly due to internal hernia, something like that. So I just want to assess this on the coronal images. Yeah, I think I can see like just there, I'm not sure if you can see my mouse, but
yeah.
I can see kind of transition points in the bowel loops. So this suggests essentially. Yes, I'm gonna just stick with my diagnosis of closed loop obstruction here.
Closed loop obstruction is a general term which can happen before. So. You are close to it. Actually, you've got it. I just want you to use that word. Maybe you used it also. Just conclude the case.
Yes,
you did very well.
So I think that It's essentially in the lower abdomen pelvis, there are dilated ribs of small bowel, which show evidence of ischemia. The configuration of these bowel and the transition points are suggestive of internal hernia causing
Excellent. Well done.
closed
Well
loop
done.
obstruction.
Well done. Okay. Internal hernia with closed loop small bowel infarction. So internal hernias can be quite a few types. And there is one type which is, you know, sometimes these things can happen after surgeries and things like that. Basically, there has to be a defect in the mesentery. And that is a predisposing factor. So interestingly, paraduodenal hernias, they are congenital internal hernias resulting from protrusion of bowel loops into congenital paraduodenal fossa through abdominal mesenteric defects, right side, left side, two types. And add to it, you know, something which is acquired type of hernia, because there will be a, you know, post-surgical, post-trauma, etc., there will be a defect in the mesentery, which will predispose to internal hernia. This picture tells you everything. And I think our case is close to this one, right? Where it just, you know, goes into a sac, and the sac is made up of mesentery. This is left paraduodenal hernia. So there is an encapsulated cluster or sac-like mass of crowded small bowel loops. And this hernial sac can produce a mass effect. It can displace adjacent structures like stomach, transverse colon, etc. I think mesentery is the key. Look at the mesentery, and we will see the mesentery in our case once again. So engorged mesenteric vessels, and these vessels can loop, they can swirl, things like that. So look at the mesentery and superadded small bowel obstruction, and look for ischemia, particularly if, you know, enhancement, non-enhancement, etc., etc. So clinically, it's very interesting because these patients can live with this paraduodenal hernia for their life. And at times, it can cause vague symptoms. But the presentation, interestingly, can be 4 to 6 decades, where they will come to you with, you know, this kind of obstruction. And so if you pick it up incidentally, this paraduodenal hernia without obstruction, the clinicians, the surgeons, they will go for surgery, because 50% of them, very high, more than 50% lifetime risk of strangulation or incarceration. So all paraduodenal hernia should be surgically repaired with closure of mesenteric defect. So this is key concept for you to remember. Now, a few examples. This is a barium on which you can see this encapsulated cluster of duodenal loops. And so this is an incidentaloma. Right now, the patient hasn't got obstruction. And you have to advise, you know, red light it to the blue light, should I say, to the surgeon that, you know, this is it. And of course, they can do it electively, but don't sit on it. And look at this from StatDX, very good example, where a cluster is present on a plain film, right? On a plain film, you can see it. And you, once you know that this kind of picture can happen, you can make it up. Same thing on a CT scan. And look at this vessel here. This is a mesenteric vein, which is vessel, which has deviated. And this is another example, a non-enhanced CT scan. Further example, similar example. Here, there is a bit of dilatation and obstruction. This is right paraduodenal hernia. And look at these vessels. Now, compare these vessels with these vessels, and you will agree that these vessels muscles are slightly engorged. Go back, let's go back to our case. Now, our case was this one. Now, if we go to the axial and see it here. Now, the key thing, once you pick it up, it is very obvious that these bowel loops are not enhancing, so they are infected. Now, what is happening? Look at the mesentery. Now, look at this and how they are twisting. This tells you everything. Just look at the vessels. Even on axial, you can make out. And then what is happening that, there, you know, there is a lot of edema within the mesentery. So it's quite an advanced case. And there is a lot of edema around the vessels. Engorgement of vessel was a previous, you know, finding. Now it has become more advanced. Again, you can see this picture, just like that, you know, diagram which I showed you. And you can see a lot of edema and thick vessels. And then you can see this swell sign of the mesentery. So this is paraduodenal hernia. So well done. Let's just 1 second stop sharing. Yeah. I think Osirix has collapsed. Just 1 second. Second last case of the day. Over to you, candidate 4. Candidate 4, should I? So this is the second last case of the day.
Okay. Just make my way to the top of the abdomen. So I'm presented with axial slices of the abdomen. These are in the
this is a 55-year-old, pain abdomen, abdominal distension, epigastric pain. That is the history.
Good enhancement of the abdominal aorta here. It's in the aortic face. Yes, arterial face. Just going to scroll through. See if anything catches my eye first. Nothing has caught my eye. I'm just going to scroll through a bit more systematically now. I'm just looking at the solid abdominal organs first. There's fatty infiltration of the pancreas.
Okay, look at the large bowel, please.
Large bowel, okay. So large bowel, I like to start from the rectum. Work my way up. So there's a sigmoid diverticulosis.
Please continue, I'm not interested.
It's uncomplicated, there's no significant adjacent fat surrounding. Just assessing the descending colon. So it's not dilated. Assessing the hepatic flexure, everything is here, assessing the transverse colon. So colonic diverticuli, but they are indicated. Assessing the ascending, hepatic flexure and ascending colon now. Something going on here, I think. Just going to better look at this, starting from the cecum, going up. So up until now, the ascending colon has a normal wall. It's not thickened. Here, just around the hepatic flexure. Things are still looking a bit abnormal to me. So there's a large. Okay. So in the lesser sac. There's a large confined free air. Just trying to make out what this is.
Will I change the window? Help you?
Yes, please. If you could. Give me the lung window, please. So it's a continuation with the colon. I'm just trying to assess whether this is a perforation or is this actual large bowel. So it looks like it's large bowel.
What is your conclusion?
My conclusion here, Dr. Khan, is that in the right upper quadrant, there is evidence of perforation of the colon. The reason I say this
it's
is because
the patient is not all that unwell. And, you know, if you read hernias can be external and internal.
Yes.
Now, your last case was your internal hernia. You remember your last case?
Yes, yes.
And do you know the classification of internal hernias? Name a few in the abdomen.
Things like when you get herniation through the spaces.
Your mind is absolutely spot on. So, with that background, can you conclude this?
And so, I think this looks like a herniation of the kind of colon, hepatic flexure, transverse colon through the mesentery for the colon. It has a name, it's just not coming to me at the moment.
Okay, hint. You know, peritoneal cavity has got a lesser sac and
yes.
a greater, right? So, what is that foramen through which things go into the lesser sac?
Is it Wilmslow? I'm probably saying
yeah. Okay, I'll take over.
Yeah.
That's fine. I have decided that this will be your last case because we have got, you know, a lot of time has. So I'll unless you insist that show me another case, I think I'll stop here. Let me show you what this was. We are already about 15 minutes over time. Now, this is the case. Lesser sac hernia. Lesser sac hernia. And internal hernias, you know, I showed you paraduodenal hernia with obstruction, right? So internal hernias, paraduodenal, trans mesenteric post-operative hernia. Same thing can happen in when there is a defect which is post-operative. And this is what you were looking for. Foramen of, which you were looking at, foramen of Winslow hernia. And then perisecal hernia, intersigmoid, transomental hernias. Of course, paraduodenal are left 75, right 25, we already covered it. So basically, internal hernia, what has happened is that through the epiploic foramen or foramen of Winslow, the large bowel has gone. It was sitting in between the stomach and the liver. You know, the classical gastrohepatic ligament or the lesser omentum territory. So let's go back to this case. So it was a good case to, again, you know, learning how to trace your anatomy. So of course, the distal sigmoid, etc., was fine. This is actually the descending colon and then the splenic flexure. And this, where I am pointing out, is the transverse colon. Transverse colon goes to the other side. Now the transverse colon. Now there is something happening here. And it is very tricky. Why it is tricky, I will tell you. Now, you actually picked it up. You were not very happy. Something is happening. You know, the vessels are going in. And this is that foramen of Winslow. You know, this is the pancreas. And so something, I'll change the window later on. But interestingly, I'll show you, first of all, this very interesting finding. This thing, which was deemed as ascending colon, actually is terminal ileum. And there is a small ball feces sign of the terminal ileum. You know, and that is why, and now it becomes continuous. So this is all small bowel. So there is a bit of subacute type of obstruction. This is the foramen of Winslow. And if you change your window, then you can see that this is, you know, the cecum, etc., is sitting in between. This is the anatomy of the lesser omentum. You know, this is the stomach, this is the liver. So this is the what we call the gastrohepatic ligament, also known as the lesser omentum. It is sitting there, going through the foramen of Winslow. It's not causing complete obstruction. Please remember, the clinical was not acute. So, of course, it was causing some symptoms, but it was not acute. Same thing on corona. An interesting bit is that transverse colon. So if you see a correction, that small bowel, I mean to say, is interesting. Now, if now this is the transverse colon, it goes up. So this is the hepatic flexure, and then here you are. It is going up here, sitting there. And all of this is actually terminal ileum with feces sign, and it is in continuity with rest of the nodes. Okay, you did well, but the word foramen of Winslow was not coming to your mind, right?
Yes, thank you.
I think we are about 20 minutes over time. I wanted to show you three cases. Should I stop? Is a bit.
Dr. Khan, you've given us several hundred hours of your free time. If you would spare another 15 minutes, I'm sure we would all appreciate it. But it's okay.
Then I will show you another case. I'll show you another case. This is going to be, very. interesting case, not for classically for you know, close to 9, but because you have asked for it, I'm going to show you. You will love it and you will gain a lot from this. So previously, we used to do this 3 hour of teaching, if you remember, for 2 years, 2.5 years. Now we have reduced it to 2.5 hours, and we start late, we finish early, but we are tuned to do 3.5, 4 hours also. So for me, it doesn't matter. I am more concerned because people are sitting somewhere it's 2:30 in the morning, and somewhere it might be 3 o'clock in the morning. In any case, this is a case not to be missed. It is too good a case. I you know, one of the most fantastic cases in my collection. So with this background, over to you. So what happened was, this patient presented to A&E, 32-year-old African girl, presented to A&E with acute abdomen, and they were worried about gut ischemia and puncture, you know, that kind of thing. So, over to you.
Okay, thank you.
So, audience, you know, if you are sleepy, you know, don't miss this. This is too good a case.
So, axial slices through the abdomen in the portal venous phase. Sorry, I said portal venous phase, but okay. Just looking at the HVB system first. Kind of linear branching hypodense structures, vessels. I'm just trying to work out what these are. So they are not the hepatic veins, they are not, it's not the portal veins, so it assuming these are the cystic ducts, they are dilated, sorry, the biliary ducts, they are dilated.
Yes, they are biliary ducts, well done.
Gallbladder is diffusely thick walled with some pericholecystic free fluid.
Can you give me the mouse, please? Just give me the mouse, just for a moment. Over to you.
So the non-liverings of the kidneys, normal enhancement of the kidneys. Patient has an NG tube, stomach, and the pancreas. Normal appearance of the pancreas, but there is some free fluid in the upper abdomen.
Okay, so because of time factor, I'm going to sort of guide you.
Okay.
So you picked up something happening in the biliary system. Can you look at the gut, please?
Yes. Okay. Just some of the upper abdomen. I'll just start with the stomach. As I mentioned, it's an NG tube. I can't appreciate. So there are some dilated loops of small bowel. Just gonna assess the colon.
Okay, just 1 second, please. One second. Look at the spleen.
Spleen, okay. So the spleen has you know, multiple round, hyperdense lesions.
Okay, keep you know, I will guide you. Give me the mouse, give me the mouse, give me the mouse. I've taken over the mouse, and I am now showing you corona. Over to you.
Okay, can I move the images or?
Yes, you can.
Yeah.
Mouse, take over the mouse. Maybe ask again if you cannot.
It's working. So these small bowel loops don't look, I mean, dilated, but there are some prominent loops. Some of them have very kind of thick wall. Some of them show kind of wall thickening.
Yeah.
Small bowel loops.
Yeah.
I think I can appreciate some mesenteric nodes as well, some soft tissue nodes within the mesentery.
Okay. What do you think about the thickness, you know, thickening of stomach?
Yes.
What about the ascending colon? A bit of.
Yes, it does look thick walled. Ascending colon looks thick walled.
Right.
Does this patient have any known history of primary malignancy?
No.
Is she immunosuppressed at all?
Why are you asking that?
I'm asking that because she's young and this diffuse small bowel thickening with mesenteric nodes, lymphoproliferative disorder is coming to my mind. She's young, but haven't assessed everything else, to be honest, yet.
Okay, just hold on, please. Just hold on. Over to you.
Okay, so the common bile duct is dilated diffusely.
So let's see the finding. Just one second. Because of time factor,
if
what you have described, I am taking over the mouse.
Yes.
What you see. This is the CBD, and CBD has got enhancing walls, right? There is something happening inside the biliary system, right? You see this density is inside.
Yes.
And with that, we can see where is the spleen. So a spleen will be, you know, this spleen has got these enhancing small nodules. Now look at the stomach, and you will agree that the stomach is partly thick walled. Agreed?
Okay. Yes.
And look at this. Agreed? This is the ascending colon, right?
Yes.
A bit, you know, thick walled. So, and look at the transverse colon against thick walled. And let me go to an axial and describe. You know, this is the biliary system, and this biliary system is all dilated, and with this enhancing wall, something is sitting inside it. This is the gallbladder, and then this is the spleen, which has got multiple nodules. this is the stomach, which has got thick walls. And then, just to show you, look at this transverse colon. Look how, you know, loss of Ruggi, agreed? Correction, loss of ostra, and thick wall. And look at the ascending colon, thick wall. So what do you think is happening? Only 32 years old. No malignancy.
So the ascending colon and transverse colon is affected, multiple splenic nodules, biliary system is dilated in this.
I'll give you 15 seconds to make up your mind. Anything comes to your mind? No? I'll show you another window. One window.
Okay.
Right? Let me make it smaller. Here you are. I'm showing you bone window.
So she's got these H-shaped vertebrae. So is this lady is evidence of avascular necrosis of the superior and inferior end plates? 32-year-old African. So this lady has sickle cell disease.
How do you explain the findings? So let me tell you, your diagnosis is correct. Explain the findings to me.
So, high density nodules in the liver, and the high density structures in the biliary system.
Okay, let me take over. You know, this is, as I told you, this is one of the most fantastic cases you will ever see. And let me sickle cell disease, gut ischemia, sickle cell cholangiopathy, splenic infarction in evolution, bone infarction. Now the point is that the mind, you know, the eye see what the mind knows. That is the key. Now sickle cell disease is a very common exam condition. We know so many things which come in the exam, you know, avascular necrosis, this and that, autosplenectomy, but we never realize that there is more to sickle cell than just this. A very good article from Radiographics, read it, it's free. You can just Google it and download it. And basically, please remember the concept in sickle cell disease. Sickle cell disease, you know, the sickling, it happens in small vessels. So any organ, the small vessels can, you know, there can be hypoxia. Just remember this much, that any organ, small vessels, can be involved. And then from the same article, this tells you everything. It's not just bone and, you know, things like that, which are, you know, spleen. There is a, you know, there is a lot of hepatic involvement, biliary involvement. Then, so this is the pathophysiology, vascular, spleen, we know, renal, then GI. And of course, there can be in heart, etc., musculoskeletal, we know. Now, in this case, the patient presented with, you know, symptoms of acute ischemia of the bowel. That is why she presented. You know, the history was not very good. This patient was not our patient. It was not in our hospital. Later on, I think two HRCTs were imported from another hospital. Otherwise, in our hospital, there was no imaging. And actually, on presentation, this is what is happening. And, you know, if I show you this bowel in toxic megacolon type of a picture, loss of fostra, you know, loss of fostra, and there is a differential diagnosis. So this is what is happening. And interestingly, bowel ischemia in sickle cell disease up to 12% of cases. And then comes cholelithiasis. Stone formation happens in 18 to 33%. And what is the cause? Cause is chronic hemolysis. And these stones are pigment stones. Pigment stones are high signal on T1 weighted MR. And I'm going to show you one. And 50% of stones are calcified. 50% of them are calcified. Then there can be cholangitis. Now, this is interesting. What is the pathophysiology of cholangitis? It is small vessel cholangiopathy. You know, the enhancement of that bile duct, that is not cholangitis as in infective, but infective cholangitis can be a secondary possibility. It is what we call ischemic cholangitis, very interesting pathophysiology. And this is known as sickle cell cholangiopathy. Secondary infections can develop. This is the CT scan. This is the MR. I'm going to go back and show you the imaging. Very interesting finding. In your, you know, in FRCR, they ask so many times on a plain film, they will ask a calcified, what we call spleen. And you say that this is autosplenectomy. This is autosplenectomy in evolution. Key point to remember, the tissue which is enhancing is still normal. It can be nodular, it can be rounded, right? And rest of the spleen is in fact it fibrosed, but till now it's not calcified. So once again I repeat, the what is enhancing is still viable nodule. Rest is gone. Now, this is an MR scan of the same patient, and I'll show you an MR, but it also tells you the beauty of MR, where we have done a non-contrast arterial venous 3-minute delay, 5-minute delay, 10-minute delay. You see, these enhancing nodules are the viable tissue, and rest of it is fibrosis. So it's a small, but till now it's not calcified. Fibrosis shows delayed enhancement. And this is how we diagnose a mass forming intrahepatic cholangiocarcinomas, which have got fibrosis inside. So this, just compare this with this, and you will agree that initially these nodules are enhancing. This is not enhancing. In the delayed one, it is enhancing. It is all fibrosed. What does it tell you? That most of the spleen is fibrosed, but these nodules are still viable. They are still alive. Now, let me go through this case. Now, what happened was that if you go here on this CT scan, we can see this intrahepatic duct dilatation, enhancement of the walls of the biliary tree. You can see that there is some high density material, and these are those calculi we were referring to. If you look at the spleen has got these nodules, which are, you know, viable tissue. Rest is sort of fibrous spleen. This is the large bowel, correction, the stomach, the large bowel, which is also ischemic, and then we have got the ascending colon, which is thick walled. So what we did was we did an MR for this. And on MR, look at this T2 weighted sequence. Look at, you know, even here you can make out how thick is the wall of the CBD. And this is because of that cholangiopathy. And these are high signal, sorry, these are so many stones sitting inside. It is full of stones. And of course, I showed you the spleen. So I don't want to waste further time, but I want to show you a T1 weighted sequence. This is a T1 weighted fat saturated sequence. Here, the learning point or the take home point is look at the bile. The bile has got high signal on T1. What is the point to remember? Pigment stones are high signal on T1. actually it is full of, you know, it is so distended, dilated, it is full of these stones or whatever material it is. And of course, on this, you know, this thing, this, you know, I don't want to waste further time on the spleen because I showed you in a slice manner. But having said that, on the post contrast, you can see this enhancement of the wall and everything. Now, we imported two CT scans of this patient. Interestingly, these CT scans were HRCTs only. So this is the only thing, and these were about 8 or 10 months old. The HRCT, because the patients can develop lung symptoms, and that is why they had must have done in another hospital. Interestingly, this is 8 months old. And do you see this? On this HRCT, you can see stone sitting there. And look at these. The last slice shows stone. So these things were sitting there. And of course, in our case, there was avascular necrosis, avascular necrosis of both. And then there is H-shaped vertebrae, which is quite classical for sickle cell. And they will show you in plain films also in your exam. And this is how, you know, the concept is that in this region, there are end arteries, and in this region, there are more arteries, and that is why the infarction is in the middle. H-shape on a AP film and H-shape on a lateral, both can happen. Now, interestingly, if you go back to the HRCT, which was this one, and go to the shoulder, this was 8 months old. And, you know, look at the femur. This femur, head of femur, both were involved. Both were, here you are, sclerosis of head of femur, 8 months old. Let me show you here. So here you are. You see this? This is avascular necrosis of head of femur and avascular necrosis here. And finally, on our visit, we did a chest x-ray and an abdominal x-ray. And this per se is an exam film because there is a bit of sclerosis here. I don't know if I can convince you, but I can see it here. And I can see it here also, where I am pointing out. With that, there is a bit of head shape, and in the exam, this will happen. You know, you will ask for a new window, and you can see this head here. You can see this head. And then we did an abdominal x-ray, which was this one, and this is another exam case where edge of the film shows you avascular necrosis, head shape. So this is sickle cell. And in an exam case, you might find a calcified spleen also. So the unifying diagnosis is what it is. Okay, candidate 4. Enjoyed the case?
Yes, thank you, Dr. Khan. Case.
Yeah. So have you ever seen a cholangiopathy, sickle cell cholangiopathy?
No, I couldn't put the things together. But yeah, that was an excellent case. Thank you.
So this is very nice, you know, and that radiographic article I have referred to, read that, and you know, in two pictures you can make your, so this is what I say, you know your pathology, make your radiology. If you know it, this can happen, that microvascular and this organ, and you can make everything, right?
Yes.
Okay then, thank you very much.